Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. In today's video, we continue with the series LLMOPS, and today we are going to train a small GPT model from scratch, and we will do this locally in our local computer. The idea of the video of today is just show what is the process of creating the dataset and train a model, create a new model from scratch, and then run inference locally. I also want to show you some of the problems that you may face if you pretend to do this in with one of the models that we had today, even some of the smaller ones. What is the problem that you may face, the amount of hardware you may need, and the cost that it will have, and some of the topics that you need to know when you pretend to do attacks like this. We are going to use a GPT2 model. It's one of the first models. It's not the first that OpenAI released 5 years ago, November 2019. So this is well, prehistory of the LLMs today. You had to probably you can imagine how difficult was at that time train a model with 170 million parameters. That was a monster at that time, or produce the large version, extra large version with 1.5 million of parameters. 5 years ago, the state of the art in technology in terms of the infrastructure, meaning that GPUs or libraries, Everything was a completely different story from what you know today or what we know today, and then it was really a feat to do this training, especially considering that they use a data set of 40 gigabytes of the text, plain text, documents extracted from Reddit, the what they say the wet text dataset, and they train the model with the technology that they had available at that time, which was not much in comparison, obviously, with what we have today in terms of offer in the cloud, using cloud providers or using one of the providers that are specialized in provide accelerated computing. Even NVIDIA didn't have this. What you know today was not available anywhere. So it's again, it was really a feat. I will show you how long it will take and how much it could cost even to train, to do the same, to replicate the same that OpenAI did 5 years ago, probably six, because November 2019 was the time that when they released the paper and the model to the public. So they were using technology and libraries, infrastructure that was available 6 even 7 years ago, Python version, etcétera, everything. So Transformers as well was really at the beginning. Also, if I don't remember wrong, let me just 1 second. Yeah, exactly. The paper "Attention is All You Need" was released, which is the base of Transformers technology, was released in 2017. So what you are going to see today was just the origins of everything that we know today in terms of LLMs, and I wanted to show you what is how to do it. It's not very different to how you can train a conventional neural network, but I think it's worth it to know all these details and also have an idea of how the big companies are training, how much they could be spending in training models like GPT-4 or Gemini or Claude 3 Sonnet. These models which are monsters in comparison with the GPT-2 small. And then you will see now I will explain you how much you need in terms of infrastructure and time to replicate exactly what they were doing with technology available today. To train just simply the same that OpenAI did 5 years, 6 years ago. And well, it's, I think, again, very interesting to understand what these guys really did and how you can, well, replicate it on your local environment. It would be not a complete process, obviously, because of matter of time. It's impossible to replicate in a local environment the training. That's why I say training a nanoGPT, which is going to be using the architecture of GPT2 is small, and then we will train it locally, not with the original data set, with a small data set, just to you get an idea of how you can do it, and later on we will run inference locally, o sea, text generation. So I have prepared, let me find it, an output as usual. Where is this exactly? Here, and I will upload later the notebook to the repo, and also you will be able to get all the links. You have all the links here to get the paper and the information you need to want to go deep into the architecture. So the model is essentially the practically replicating the architecture of the paper, 12 decoders, layers of decoders in the small one. We are going to use some of the scripts that Andrei Karpathy provide. This is one guy from Stanford University, which is excellent AI researchers. You can take a look to the here. You had all part of the stuff that he provides. It's really, really interesting. We will cover some script that he used, and I will just show you how to use them, case that you didn't use before. And again, we will be just looking at what the stat that Andrei just provide to us to do that. So here I just pass you the stuff you need to install in your computer. Obviously, you want to work with a GPU, install Tor with support, GPU support. It's not also it's possible to run it in the CPU. It will be obviously take longer, but it's possible. For the sample that we are going to do today, I'm using a very small data set. I take just a book, The Great Gatsby, which is essentially 300,000 characters, kind of 70,000 different tokens. This is obviously not a data set that you may use to train. That was the original data set used to train GPT-2. 8 million documents, 40 gigabits, which has 40 million of leads coming mostly from Reddit. They didn't use Wikipedia in that case, just links from Reddit, at least Karma, which contains like 3 stars. So today just we will see how to prepare the dataset. If you want to replicate it according to the information that Andrei provide, the same exercise today, it could take, he made the exercise, you had the code here to run the experiment. He was using a node with 8 GPUs, 8 A100, so in total 320 gigabytes of the GPU VRAM. So this is a really expensive Just for other, well, if you are not a company, I think that you are not able to afford this. Even to request it to a cloud provider, you probably are not. If you are not a company, they will not provide you a node with this size. So I'm struggling to get a T4 in Azure or in Google Cloud. So it's very, very difficult to get a node like this if you are not you don't have an enterprise subscription. So you just take replicate the training that the OpenAI did, took 4 days, and using a node with 8 GPUs A100. Also, he was using DDP, data distributed data distribution processing, distributed data processing, which means that you split the data in batches to different GPUs. So that's meaning that obviously you reduce the time of the training time. There is some penalty in terms of synchronizing gradients and weights using that technology, but in any case it's better than to do it in a single GPU, obviously, no? But yeah, in any case, that is the what you may need to do it. That he was doing here token encoding the documents using the tokenizer, the tick token library, and we are gonna do today something similar, which is also part of the notebook. Well, let's start, and I will explain you while I'm covering the notebook. So we had 4 versions. We are gonna use the smaller one. We have 768 size of embeddings, and then on 12 decoders groups in this model. Again, 118 millions of characters. So probably you know that the GPT-2 is just a decoder technology, not the GPT architecture. Exactly. For those that they are not or not much familiar with the architectures, I will pass you later on as well this link. But well, essentially, GPT's architecture are only decoder, only the decoder block of the technology. So, in this case, GPT-2 small is 12 decoder blocks, and then on you have also there is a comparison here with Bear and Bart, no, all the technologies encoder, Bear using encoder. Decoder and Bear, other very famous technology, use only the encoder one. I will pass you this link. There is some other documents. This is probably one of the best I found in internet explaining the difference among different architectures, transformers architecture. Well, the smaller one, again, 12 decoders, stacked decoders blocks, and that's what the one with a 768 embedding size. So I just make a test here. You have the model available in Hugging Face Hat. You can just simply create a pipeline, a text generation and generation test. It's pretty easy. Just give you an example of how you can use it. Then on to prepare the dataset, here we are going to work character level. It's pretty similar to what they did here at token level. We will just use instead to generate the next the next token, we are going to generate the next character. Essentially, obviously, it was not what they were doing during the training, but for simplicity and also to reduce training time and be able to show you in a reasonable time, I did it in a chart level rather than to do. But again, the process, as you will see, is going to be essentially the same. So I took a book. This Enrique used in the example, another book is a Shakespeare book. I use another one, which is The Great Gatsby. The document in my case is 3 times smaller, so well, but in terms of what one achieved is going to be really similar. Well, the idea here, you read the document, you create a list of the different charts contained on the book. With the, we created this with this sentence here, and then this list is the our vocabulary size. If you are using tokens, tokens, you can, to do a simplistic comparison, you can compare a token with a word. It's not exactly the same, because tokens, a word may contain multiple tokens, especially if you have a prefix or suffix. But well, just for simplicity, consider a token a word, and then you may do the same when you are tokenizing a document. It's exactly the same that we did here, but instead to count the, you need to split the document, for example, using the space, or the tabulator, depending on space and tabulators, for example, and then on, you may have a long list of the with all the words or tokens that you have in your document, and then on you do a set to that list. In this way, you create your vocabulary of tokens as well. It's exactly the same process. The only thing that varies is the way that how you split the token. Here we are splitting in charts, and then on in, no, usually you split based on words. No, in the case of the in the repo, you will find different. So when you are going to work token level, he is using the TIC token library. TIC token is developed by OpenAI, and it provides a tokenization based on the different models they have. If you are going to do, you can do this the same training with the Shakespeare book you have with a character level and a token level, and this is obviously the faster one is character level. The Shakespeare level, so the token level is slower, obviously, in comparison with the character one, and this one is the script prepared to replicate the process of the same training that OpenAI use. As you can see here, we have these tokens in this dataset, Open Web Text, if we use Shakespeare, we have Teeny Shakespeare. I think this is wrong. These numbers are not realistic. Prepare, but well, and a character level you have much more tokens. They are just counting the number of tokens, and then the one is not really correct. Probably it's this. No, exactly. No, I was opening wrongly the file. If you take the open web, you see there is 9 millions of tokens in train for, no, 9 millions, no, 9,000 millions of tokens. It's a very big data set, so it's going to take, as he mentioned, and considering that they are using for GPUs, that this is unaffordable to do it in a local domestic computer. With this, what I wanted to tell you is that just imagine the amount of the data and the amount of time and money that a company like Google or OpenAI used to train the actual models, like GPT-4 or Gemini or even Anthropic or whoever, or even Meta, which is as well datasets with trillions of tokens and sizes of the like the Llama 3 1.1 with 490 billion parameters. This is essentially a huge data set in comparison with the ones that we have, with the one that we are going to do here. So sorry, it was an interruption. So as I was saying, training in the case that you are going to use open web text or you want to use tokens with the Shakespeare book, you will be using the TIC token library to do the tokenization and the encoding the coding, so transforming the text to tokens and creating the vocabulary, and similarly you simply the toy book, which in comparison with the web data sets is practically nothing. It's just 1 megabyte of data. Here we have 40 gigabytes of data. So as I was explaining, just take into consideration we are going to spend three hours to train the model in a, obviously this is a domestic GPU, GTX Force 1650 with 4 gigabytes of memory. Andrei Karpati took 4 days to train the model in a node with 8 GPUs, A100, so 320 using data distribution, data distribution parallelization, which allow us to send different batches to different GPUs. Obviously the model, this small model, is absolutely no problem to load it in a GPU like the A100. But yeah, this is, as I mentioned before, is not affordable for a person, obviously not for me, not for, yeah, and not for many companies. So this is a process that is still this kind of task still remains on the big tech providers like or LLM providers like Meta, Google, Microsoft, OpenAI or Anthropic, which spend millions on that. I remember I was doing one of the videos I said in the channel, we explained the training process of GPT-4, and they spend approximately $500 million in training the model. So this again is not only the money, it's also the hardware you need. You need to be a corporation or even have your own data center to train the model like this, because you need thousands and thousands of GPUs. And then just imagine that the process is how to say, failing, or you make a mistake, you need to create a really long or complex engineering process to recover from that, because well, it's not you may lose a lot of money. Here we are gonna do just a small example character level, but you will see that it's exactly the same. Once I explain you, it's exactly the same that doing a tokenized or do the training based on tokens. So what we do here is just we open our training set, our raw data. We count the number of characters in this case that we do the tokenization in tokens or words. We will split the data differently. We just count the number of the different characters we have on the document, and then this is our bucket size, and then we create the ID to label and label to ID dictionaries, which tell us essentially this char is this identifier and vice versa, this identifier is this char. Once we have created the dictionaries, we create the functions to talk to encode and to decode according to our mappings or dictionaries that mapping the characters, in this case, of tokens to integers, and the decode function to do the opposite. What more? Oh, this is not needed. This is duplicate. Okay, so we count the number, we look at the number, the length of our data, and we create a train test data set. And essentially, here you see that we don't really care if the, where we do the cutoff. It's a, we are going to generate character to character, one character after the next. And you can see how it works, the process of the encoding. You just simply encoding the our data set. It's exactly the same, exactly the same with tokens. Yeah, we got a long vector with the numbers, with the, in this case with the integers, and you can use the dictionaries, in this case the label to ID. So you can check here the position 5 or the I number 4 is a 58, is an E. And then if you use the label to ID dictionary, you can check that in the, if you just slice the position E, you get the number 58. Exactly, you use the P, I suppose that is gonna be 41, like the one here, and so on and so forth. This again is exactly the same when you tokenize a document. You are creating similar dictionaries, but rather than to have characters, you have tokens in that case, and then on you later assign a token to an identifier and create these two dictionaries. Tokenizing and encoding our test is essentially that. Later on we will do an splitting of this long vector in chunks, and this chunks has a size of 1024. And we will produce an encoding of 768. So once we had the train, the list of tokens, we convert it to NumPy arrays and we save it in binary format to the folder, and then we create our metadata or tokenizer metadata that later on we will use. Here we train the model. Let's take a look to the train model. I have it here, but there's a train model. We can use the same for training or fine-tuning the approach that is followed, which is just changing the parameters. It's not using any library to do a systematic fine-tuning like a random or grid search or Bayesian hyperparameter tuning. It's just simply changing the parameters and use with a what the engineer thinks that is more appropriate, but well, it's again is using the same script, no? As you can see here, you had all the necessary to use as well the DDP, distributed data parallel, and we have some parameters. We are gonna chunk the model in batches of 12. Every batch is 1024. It can be tokens, it can be chars. We use the smaller model, 12 layers, with an embedding of 768. And here you have dropout 0, no dropout in few words, and solo the parameters we need. Type, depending if you are working in CUDA or not CUDA, and the backend that you are using, you may be able to use vfloat. I'm using vfloat 16 for the training, and well, again, depending which one the script is ready to train with the wet text dataset, but obviously you will not be able to do it in your local environment unless that your local environment has a multiple GPUs with a size to run the process in a reasonable time. Because just imagine that here with just 5,000 steps took 3 hours in my computer. I don't think it's a big problem in terms of the size. We may yeah, there is no problem of having a out of memory using my GPU with such size. 1024 tokens. Yeah, probably the batch, depending on the size of the batch, will be not much. But yeah, when we had the 40 gigabytes data set that they use for training, the problem is that you had a lot of the batches. And then even if you create long batches and use the distribution, this is gonna take a lot of time. But well, it's just you, sorry, following the same approach, you just use the same script. And then what more, we have here the method to create the batches. You can see here we use the block size and we are stacking, we are taking from the original train data set a random begin, a random size of the yeah a random batch considering the length of the data. So here we just simply calculate the point where we have a point in the data sets, an index in the data sets randomly with this, and we calculate with these endpoints. We just simply calculate, sorry, beginning points. We just calculate a vector with the length of batch size and with the size considering the all the indices index that we had on the vector training vector, which is a very long vector with all the characters or tokens that you have in your training data set. And here we are just creating, so we choose randomly per batch batch size beginnings, and then we create from those beginnings and considering the block size vectors from we extract vectors from this training data set, and then we convert it to TORCH tensors. So here after that we had our training data and the Y data is essentially the validation data. Okay. So once we had the batch created, we just simply we had different options. Start from scratch is the default mode. Resume case that it was stopping every time that you run you finish an epoch. It's gonna save the model. It is the conditions. It meet the conditions. You go here to the true. If it So if the loss of validation is better than the best validation loss, we save the model. So it's just saving the best checkpoint. And then on if for any reason the process breaks, you can restart the process using the auction resume. Okay. What more? You can, again, you can use a training from scratch, resume, in case that you had any problem, or you just simply stop it, or you can simply as well download the weights from the GPT2, the original weights, and train the model or use the model like that. Here, we are just changing the optimizer here. Some helpers to estimate the loss, get the learning rate. If you are using the K, not the K, the learning rate. If you are using warm mode iteration or not warm mode, well, just calculating the learning rate according to the parameters that you choose on the. You choose by default, everything by default is here. So here, you had the default, this is the default config, and you had the different configs parameters here in the config file. We are using this for the train characters. The default is not pass any configuration. You can see here in run nanoGPT, I'm passing the train speed charge PI. So if you pass a configuration file, it will overwrite what you had in the following script. So where is this? Oops, I did train speed. Ah, here. So here another tip. Usually on the original script, the one that comes with the repo, this is true. This means that they use the Triton compiler. This is a library as well that similar to, if you know, GIT compiler, the just-in-time compiler is doing something similar to what the just-in-time compiler is doing, but applied to creating blocks in neural network. It's just optimizing, creating cache, or optimizing the modules to speed up the process of training. That simple than that. You have here some examples. I plan to do some video to just showcase how it works, the library. And also is something that is broadly used in NVIDIA environments, as the implementation is done in C++ with APIs in Python and other languages. This is the implementation in Python. So, as I said, by default, is coming this true. If you try to do the train and you don't have a GPU compatible with the Triton, process will fail. In my case, the process failed because my GTX 1650 is not compatible for this kind of training to compile with Triton. Okay, once you have there, you train the process, it's start to train. Again, in my case, 5,000 iterations, steps took 3 hours and 15 minutes. So depending on your computer, it will take longer. If your plan is just to understand how you can train the model, it's up to you how long you want to take it, I just give you a reference of how long it took in my case. Just consider how long could take in your case if you change the parameters. Here the case that you don't have a GPU, that is to run this in a CPU, in hardware CPU only. And then here we had another script to do generation, text generation, similar to what we did at the beginning, using the original model and transformers library, the pipeline. Here you had the script, and essentially here we are pointing to the model where we had the best model after training, and then you just simply can run it, and you will see that is not fantastic. The 10.66 million, but It's also not bad. So obviously it's really tied to the data set we use for training. But the questions or the text that is generating, sometimes I think is not completely correct. But as well, we use a very, very small data set for this training. What about the graduate time? Is that nice? Some of the sentences are completely nonsense. Oh, no, this after a moment, we are going to tell these around sectors. Some others are better, if you can say that. Again, this technology, you know, is not the matter to create a model. It's just something for a training process to understand how you can train a model, and also to understand how much money and time you may need to train a medium-sized model, which could be a lot if you want to produce something that produce an output with a reasonable quality. And then obviously if you increase the number of parameters, the model will learn or produce better and more quality, or better quality, depending on how we train the model as well and in which concept it will be producing, again, depending on the data set, the kind of data. And then this raises another question, that is the amount of data that you need to train your data set. After this or the concept that the OpenAI used to train the data, this model, a part of the input representation, etc., they had the idea at that time that as much data that you provide, the best, no? And then around this concept, they create a kind of there was some rules. We cannot say laws because I think it's too much to say law to this. But well, there was different research papers that they were describing how improve the quality of the answers of these initial LLMs. Just introducing more data into the training process. This idea was finally rebate by Chinchilla after these researchers produced the Chinchilla paper, which this is by DeepMind Google, and they were investigating essentially what is the optimal size of the in terms of tokens. You see, this document is produced not far away, not at the time that OpenAI trained GPT-2. So the idea at that time, as I said, it was as much data the best. That's why, well, some of the models, they use tons and tons of data, trillions of tokens, and then the processes of training those models were really long, very expensive, and also, well, it's not only the time that we need to train the model, it's also the time that we need to collect and pre-process all the data to train the model. And then when DeepMind made this research, and they come out with the conclusion that there is a kind of optimal point where, depending on the architecture of the model, you may need more or less data. This and then on also in the repo you will find these two interesting notebooks that you can get through, and then they help you to calculate the size of the models using the configuration of the in numbers of heads, dimension of the embeddings, number of layers, etc. For example, here you have the GPT-2 nano version of the smaller version or the base version, and then on how many parameters according to the Chinchilla model you may need to train optimally your model. So there is the idea, kind of the idea that was in WebText dataset, it was kind of 20 tokens per parameter. So meaning that you need to use 20 times more data than the number of the parameters that you had in your model. Something that again was not dismantled, rebate with the chinchilla document. I think it's interesting and also understand this and this, how everything is evolving in the direction of creating not big models, not bigger models, not using more data. It's everything going in the direction of reducing cost and doing more efficient and more efficient training, because probably yeah, it is. That's what may happen 5 years ago when they trained GPT-2. Was also very difficult or very incipient the way that they were evaluating the models. There was not really an approach or a systematic approach or a benchmark like we have today. We can evaluate the performance of our models versus multiple benchmarks available today. That covers different tasks, different aspects of the models. And then what I wanted to tell you as well, we did that today, for what I understand, this is going on the direction of creating smaller models, but we also take advance as well of the new advance in hardware, in runtimes like TensorRT, OpenBINOT, new attention mechanism, new improvements on the attention mechanism, better hardware, faster hardware, bigger hardware. But apart of that, there is also a lot of the research on this matter, how we can efficiently train the model with the data that is making more efficient the training, not more, because more means more money. And then on what they try to create here with this document is you have a budget, so not every company has $500 million dollars to spend to train a model like this. So there is only few companies on the world. But if we apply the same rule, or we can make some simple calculations, if we pretend to train a model from scratch in our company, just make, even if there is 1,000 times smaller than GPT-4, we need to think for, well, this could be 1.2 billion parameters. This may cost practically $500,000. $500,000. Well, a little bit, yeah, $500,000, which is also a lot of money, no? And then just creating a, and this is probably just one go. You need to do several tests. So not training process is a very expensive and demanding resource demanding process. So it's something that we need to plan very carefully and had or being really well documented in the tasks that we are gonna do, because as you can see here, this is a process very costly. Very costly, it's tremendously costly. It's something that, again, is not affordable for many companies. And secondly, you may end up in something useless because you are not applying the correct configuration, the correct rules, or the correct process, just because the process is not correctly grounded. Another topic on part of all the research and new techniques, etc., To train these models, you need specialized people. This is something that, as well, is also not well to prepare the all the engineering to do. For example, to prepare the data sets for the distributed data processing, for example, or for using other techniques, you need the engineers who are able to prepare this. This is also has a big impact, a big cost, and then. Again, I read this is insisting no on the idea that this well we are doing here something for educational purposes. It's very interesting to know how you can do a training, but you need to be aware of all these complexities and why. This is something that is not really done for many companies. That's why, as well, today the tendency is also either you do a fine-tuning or we use other processes on top of the well-trained models that the companies like Meta or Google or whoever are producing, and where we use the power of these models, and with techniques like RAG or others, or fuse of prompting, or chain of thoughts prompting, or fine-tuning a model, we produce a model which is suitable for the requirements that we wanted. No? Nobody or not many people is training models from scratch, and then it's just an exercise what we did today here. And okay, that's pretty much all. Here I will pass you again. I will upload now this notebook to the repo. I will give you all the links as well. This run nanoGPT. You have here the links to the repository of the Andrei Karpathy, and also here you have another interesting. It's just an evolution of the same, but to do LoRa fine tuning. Which is another optimization. The fine tuning you have here is just simply changing parameters. You have here a fine tuning or here in it's using the training py, but using another configuration. But the configuration that you have here is just simply changing some parameters of the training process. It's not using Ray or Bayesian optimization, nothing like that, to discover or to find out the best parameters for that training. And that's all. That's pretty much all. I hope that it was useful. I try just to give you some insights in how the training process is done. I wanted to also showcase you the different issues that you may find when you pretend to do something like this. And again, that's pretty much all. Thank you very much for watching the video to this point. I hope that you find it interesting and useful for your training, for your work, for whatever reason are you watching this video. And if so, just give me a like, subscribe to the channel if you are not already subscribed, and make comments or whatever, share with your colleagues, just to help me to grow in YouTube. Thank you very much, and see you soon.